There's no time like the present to think about a future perfect.
Future Perfect went on the air for the first time on June 11, 2010. Throughout the first 13 episodes of the show, we managed to attract a growing number of viewers. While some had praises for the show, a few others felt it didn't deserve to be called a tech show.
Well, I think at the beginning, there were a lot of people who did find fault with the show. I'm not going to mention them anymore. You know who you are. But there are people who actually thought that we were a gadget show and nothing more, and that we sucked at being a gadget show. Of course, we tried to make them understand that that wasn't really the sole purpose of Future Perfect, that we were there not just to talk about gadgets as eye candy, you know, something fun to have and fun to use, but something more practical and more serious about how we apply technology to Filipino life. So I think we've grown to become accepted as more than just a gadget show, which we never really aimed to be. Now people who tune in and who regularly come back to watch our show do understand that the purpose of Future Perfect is to talk about national concerns, national issues, and then how we apply the technology to address these national issues.
Future Perfect looked into the aborted project to dredge the Laguna de Bay, where a renowned Belgian company had proposed to apply its technology to prevent the lake from overflowing and causing massive flood damage. The show examined how technology was used to trace and clean up a dangerous underground oil pipeline leak that had accumulated in the basement of a Makati condominium building. And months before the Great Sendai earthquake and tsunami in Japan sparked fears over the hazards of nuclear power plants, Future Perfect looked into the revival of proposals to harness nuclear energy for the Philippines' growing power needs.
Knowing that there's an International Atomic Energy Commission that could oversee, if ever we recommission it, no? Mm-hmm. Oversee the plant's operation, and knowing that it can be validated mm-hmm. by experts mm-hmm. in the field, let's seek their validation. So that's what my bill first and foremostly wants to do. I would like to get a validation from people in the know.
Sure.
That way it will allay the fears, and hopefully mm-hmm. public acceptability would be present. And number two, we are in an age right now where everybody's going nuclear. But I'm not saying we should go because everybody's doing it.
Yeah, because you're going to sound like it's just a bandwagon
yes,
effect, right?
No. Mm. More importantly is our country is at a standstill economically. Why? One of the major reasons, and I think it is the major reason, mm. is because our electric power rates are the second highest
right.
in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So how do we expect to lift ourselves economically and invite investors when our power is so expensive? If ever we decide to go nuclear,
okay.
it's going to cost us $7 billion to put up a new plant
mm-hmm.
and about 10 years
mm-hmm.
to build.
Mm-hmm.
We have one sitting right here, right under our noses, mm. a gold mine, if it's declared safe.
If it's declared safe.
We have one, and it's fully paid for.
And you've estimated it will only cost $1 billion compared to $7 billion.
To recommission it. So why are we going to put something to waste that's already there?
The plant has been designed to withstand 0.4 Gs, and then it's not so much the fault. It has to be an active fault, and there has to be big ground shaking.
0.4 what?
0.4 G.
0.4 G
is 0.4 times. It's basically, if there
this
was
is
an
not
earthquake,
the Richter scale measurement.
No. If there was an earthquake, the building will have to move 4 meters per second.
Oh, okay.
And
what does G stand for?
G is the gravitational constant.
Okay.
10 meters per second
yeah,
per
yeah.
second.
So it's the
okay.
same thing as with flight. G. G
yes.
force.
Yes, yes, yeah. yes. Same
okay.
same numbers.
So 0.4 G.
0.4, that's
so,
very, very strong. In
yeah,
fact,
yeah.
I'll tell you this. If there's an earthquake, I'd like to be inside the core.
yeah. Why would you want to do that?
Because it's I know it can withstand it.
So
I mean,
it's the safest place
yeah.
to be.
I mean, you know, if the NPC will allow me to operate it, I can live beside it. It's mature technology.
Mature technology.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, the countries and everybody wants it, and we have one plant already finished, and it's not old.
Yes.
It's new. It's never been used.
And you know,
and there's a plant in Korea that's been running since 83 exactly the same.
Yeah, kakambal niyan.
Kakambal niyan. So you have a, it's like a prototype
that has never been put into operation. Yeah.
Now, all of these were very serious issues that did call for a 3D treatment on Future Perfect, so to speak. 3D as in dynamic, detailed discussions. But my crew and I were also inclined to give our stories a bit of a humorous treatment.
When we did start writing our first reports for Future Perfect, we didn't want technology to become this somber and very academic-like discussion of technology, because we want technology to be fun. First of all, that's how people look at it. I mean, Filipinos look at technology as high tech, so they look at technology as toys or something you have fun with. But how can you make it fun when you're talking about something as serious as aircraft navigation safety, or you're talking about a bomb disposal robot, something that you wouldn't practically have fun with? But we try to make people interested in the topic by, you know, by trying to inject a little bit of humor into it. In fact, it also helps that when we do write our stories before, and even up to now, we sort of put a little pun into the story, and even by maybe equating it to some movies that people may have watched before, and how these technologies that we're featuring actually did come out in these movies. So, you know, humor and technology do have, you know, they can go together. They're very compatible. So I think that we'll still be continuing with the humor, no matter how corny it sometimes gets, just so that we can put our some of our guests at ease. Like, for example, say that math whiz, John Gabriel Pelias. I would imagine that math is all serious stuff, but of course, when we paired him with a beauty queen, Shamsi Soup Soup, I think that helped to break the ice a little bit faster.
But as Future Perfect ventured further into its, well, future, my crew and I looked into how technology could also help viewers enjoy a more exciting lifestyle. It was timely that in the first months Future Perfect was on the air, the tech world saw the rise of tablets and smartphones.
First of all, I think, you know, our fascination with gadgets really can't be avoided. I mean, it's really just part of human nature. Filipinos not exempted. But one thing I also tried to show that, for us at least, that something that could be just seen as a gadget can also be a productivity tool. So we started out by showing what the iPad, which actually really helped a lot in producing the show, what it could do for us in one episode when we showed how the iPad can be used, you know, for broadcast technology itself. We showed how the iPad could be used as our portable teleprompter. We showed how we actually composed the theme music for Future Perfect on that device. And we actually showed how we dispense with printing hard copies on paper for scripts, because we actually transfer our scripts as PDF files to the iPad. So gradually from there, we're showing that digital devices or some forms of gadgets can actually be very practical to use. They don't have to be just, you know, toys, expensive toys. But then again, when you're talking about leisure tech, it's really nice to know that technology in itself is improving when you talk about cell phones, when you talk about digital cameras, or even game consoles. A lot of these, of course, help our viewers to appreciate the fact that technology is there for us to use. They do have their practical applications. Cameras, for example, we don't just use them to take fancy pictures of ourselves. We can install them on buses, we can install them in vehicles, and we can use them to track conditions on the road or even accidents. So, you know, my view of gadgets now, still practically the same, that they do serve a function, not just because they're nice to have and they're nice to look at, but they're also very handy when the situation calls for it.
I think the gadgets that really stuck out to me that had really had a practical application was, of course, the tablets. We had the e-result tablet on the show, and there was, which it's currently being pilot tested right now. We also had, of course, the XOPC, the one gadget, one laptop per child, the PCs that were used for those programs, which before even producing the show, that was a gadget that I heard a lot about and what impact it had on the third world countries where they were being deployed, and to have it and to actually know that it's also being used right now in the Philippines. It was, it had it brought a smile to my face that we managed to highlight that also.
I always enjoy, here's a special mention, Art Samaniego. Obviously, Art, from a tech perspective, he's got all the bases covered. I mean, when you talk about all the gadgets that you can possibly want to have, Art is the guy to go to. And it's always a pleasure to have Art Samaniego of Manila Bulletin on the show to share with us his experiences with all these devices. So he's a constant guest, I can say, Suke. We run to for latest tech innovation. So it's always nice to have Art Samaniego on the show.
On occasion, we brought Future Perfect out of our ANC studio and held it on location where we could feature various types of leisure tech.
We wanted to end the year last year, December, on a more enjoyable note, of course. And when we were thinking about what episode to come up with, we thought, you know, what would people like to go to for the holidays? And we thought, yeah, why don't we do a theme park tech episode? And it just so happened that Enchanted Kingdom, at that particular time of year, was already celebrating its 15th year anniversary. And they were going to introduce a new ride, a tower ride, which, of course, my executive producer, Dino Ponte Orig, was the guinea pig to test it out. Not because I'm chicken, but because I have vertigo. Yes, that's my alibi.
We did an episode about hi-fi. These audio enthusiasts who build these really complicated gear. We're a tech show, and when you say tech, it generally means digital. And when you say digital, we automatically assume that it's superior to all other technology. And then come these guys who say that digital is just another cheap way of storing information. And when it comes to audio, nothing beats analog. That was refreshing for me, because it gives you another perspective into the evolution of technology.
We also did the Campy International Motor Show. That was a chance for us to see some of the latest vehicles up close, including some of the concept vehicles that they had on display. Some of them were electric vehicles and some of them were just concept designs. But it's also very good to actually let our viewers know what's out there, you know, in the automotive world, in the world of automotive technology, and what we could possibly expect to see on the road maybe 5 or 10 years later on.
Up next, the Future Perfect crew and I take a look at our personal favorites among the stories and guests we've had on the show.